Good.
We can see you now, Chelsea. That's great.
Perfect. Okay, thank you so much for having me. Today I'll be talking about parenting stress and its relation to parenting. And I'd like to begin first with the territorial acknowledgement that we're on the land, that the land on which we're virtually gathering today is the traditional territories of the people of the Treaty 7 region in southern Alberta. The city of Calgary is also home to Métis Nation of Alberta Region 3. So I thought I'd begin just by providing a bit of an overview about what I'll be discussing today. First, I'll be talking about parenting stress, the causes and outcomes of parenting stress. I'll try to provide some tips about how to manage parenting stress. And then I'll introduce a study about parenting stress that I'm currently running. So just before we begin, I'll tell you a little bit about myself. I'm originally from Vancouver, born and raised, and I've slowly been making my way east through my schooling. So I completed my master's degree at the University of Calgary. And I'm in the middle, well, I guess almost done now, of my PhD in school and clinical child psychology at the University of Alberta. And so just to provide a bit of context, my PhD training involves both coursework as well as research. So the study that I'll be talking about today is my doctoral dissertation research. And then right now, so I guess the first 3 years of my training involves coursework and research. And then the last year, the fourth year, is a full 1 year internship or residency. And so I'm currently completing my residency at the Center for Addiction and Mental Health, or CAMH, in Toronto. So just to tell you a little bit about my areas of interest and expertise. So clinically, my interests involve child psychology. And so the questions I try to answer are just how I can help children, youth, and adolescents with mental health challenges and their parents. So that kind of encompasses many different types of mental health challenges for children, as well as parenting challenges for the parents, sometimes separately, sometimes together. And as I mentioned, research is a big part of my training. And so my research interests center on how children learn to manage emotions. So whether this is anger, sadness, happiness, and how they specifically learn to manage some of those like bigger, harder to manage emotions like anger and sadness. And then that kind of naturally led me into the realm of parenting and how we can make it easier for children and their parents to manage those big emotions. And so the doctoral research that I'm conducting right now is an ongoing study about the parenting experience. And so what I've done for our presentation today is I've pulled some preliminary findings from this ongoing study. And I'll mention those as we kind of work through the presentation today. And all of the preliminary research findings will be kind of outlined in yellow. So just to begin, I thought I would share a little bit about stress and what is stress. So one of the first things I thought I would share is the stress process model. So this is a general model about parenting stress. And it actually, so I guess parenting stress kind of falls under this model, but this model is believed to represent kind of how stress operates in people broadly. So first you have a source of stress. So that would be the cause of stress. And then you would have the moderating resources. So these are the supports and coping mechanisms that a person sort of naturally has or maybe is building on. And then based on the source of stress and the resources that they have to navigate or deal with that stress, then you kind of have an outcome of stress. And this outcome can be both psychological, or physical. And I wanted to provide a bit of background information as well about just the differences between stressors, distress, and the stress response. So this was something that I guess I hadn't really thought too much about until I was learning more about stress. And I thought that these were just kind of interesting distinctions. So a stressor is an external stimuli that threatens a person's functioning. So it's a specific event or a situation, could be a person. And then as a result of that, somebody might experience a stress response. And distress, on the other hand, is a maladaptive response to the presence of stress. So this might be maybe depression or something like that, or some kind of other maladaptive response. Now, parenting stress is actually a very unique kind of stress, and it's a set of processes that lead to aversive psychological and physiological reactions arising from attempts to adapt to the demands of parenthood. And so this is the sort of definition that's broadly used within the parenting stress literature, and it's provided by Dieter Deckert, who's quite a renowned parenting stress researcher. So I guess I wanted to start off just by asking a general question of the audience, and feel free to chat in your responses. But I'm curious to know what your thoughts are between parenting stress and how it might differ from a stressed parent. I'll give you guys a minute to chat in your responses.
Kelsey, it looks like some people are a little bit shy this morning, or maybe just waking up.
No problem.
Do you want to repeat what you've just asked?
Yes, sure. So just maybe some thoughts on maybe a difference between parenting stress versus stressed parents.
Oh, here they come. Here come the responses. Thank you, everyone.
Sure. So too much on one's plate, definitely. And if that might be something for both or just one, like for both a stressed parent and parenting stress, or one or the other. And this is the only response I see so far. But perhaps there are others that I can't see.
I see one here. Stressed parents is in response to external events, but parenting stress is more internal.
Okay.
Parenting stress, I think, may be related to stress with child rearing, and stressed parents can be more general. Yeah. Stressed parent feels stress, ability to cope is lower. Parenting stress is a specific source of stress from parenting.
Yeah, these are all exactly. There's a lot of overlap and some minor distinctions between them. And I think you guys are really hitting on these key concepts. So parenting stress is really sort of something internal, as you say. The parent would feel stress as a result of that parenting role, perhaps having too much on their plate, feeling overwhelmed. Whereas a stressed parent is maybe somebody who experiences, so someone who is a parent and then also experiencing stressors that are external to the caregiving role.
And it looks like we've got one more here. Parenting stress is an external force. Stressed parents are the result of stress in the individual.
Awesome. Yeah, thank you guys so much for sharing. Yeah, exactly. This is something that I hadn't really spent much time, I guess, sort of distinguishing all these nuances to stress and parents and parenting stress. And it's kind of interesting to think about, I think it is, but it's kind of interesting to think about if we can separate parenting stress, if it spills over into other aspects of our lives, And just kind of how those two things come together and if they really are, we are able to separate them.
Oh, and then somebody's added, add COVID-19 to our parenting stress already and doesn't make it any better.
So true. That's something that I'll briefly touch on, but I'm so curious to hear your thoughts as well, because we'll talk a little bit about some of the causes of parenting stress. And I think right now is kind of a unique period in time where there is a lot more on parents' plates because of COVID-19. Yeah. Thank you guys for your responses. So thinking about the levels of parenting stress, I know that stress is not really like something that is either we have or don't have, that it exists on a spectrum. And there's varying degrees of a stress response that somebody can experience. So I've kind of represented this here on a continuum. And so on the low end, the left side, you have a low levels of stress, and then you kind of have average stress in the middle, and then you might have high stress on the other end. And so you can see that average stress kind of extends for most of the continuum, but on either end, Abedin, who's also a parenting stress researcher, has flagged that really low levels of stress and really high levels of stress are actually potentially cause for concern. So in these instances, psychologists or mental health practitioners probably want to follow up with parents who might fall on either ends of these sort of the extreme ends of the spectrum, because for really, really low stress, that might be indicative of low engagement. And so that might be something that would kind of warrant a follow-up, might be a red flag. And similarly, really, really high levels of stress are also a sign that maybe the parents are feeling overwhelmed. There's too much happening, too much going on within that parenting role. And they're just feeling very taxed. So actually both ends of the spectrum are kind of a red flag, a pause for concern. And then this is sort of what my results show from my doctoral dissertation. So this is the kind of combined response from about 215 parents. And so right now they're kind of falling in that average window of parenting stress, but we are seeing a little bit higher on the average sort of side. Okay, so any thoughts about what types of factors we might want to consider when thinking about stress levels? We heard something about COVID-19, and I think that's definitely one of those things that right now is an extra consideration. It's something that researchers are actually spending a lot of time thinking about when working with families. Any other ideas that you guys can think of that might be playing a role? Disabilities, job loss. Yeah, for sure.
Disabilities, job loss, sleep, depression, anxiety, anger. Oh, lots of comments coming in. Financial struggles. Mental health of parent or child,
yeah,
problems with memory or concentration.
Yeah. You guys have really good ideas, and it's so true. I think I'll sort of contextualize this, but you guys are hitting on so many points about the different factors, social media pressure, new parent, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Making bad decisions.
Totally.
Diet, lack of support. Yeah. Excellent comments.
Yeah, meeting my child's mental needs. Yeah, these are great. Okay, so I'll kind of start to talk a little bit about some of these factors that you guys are identifying here. And when we think about some of the causes or contributors to parenting stress, it can be helpful to think about it within this ABC model. So we think of the A as the antecedents. So these are the potential causes, triggers of parenting stress. B would be the behavior, and C is the consequence. Not necessarily within the like a negative connotation, more just like the outcome of a stress response. So I'll begin by talking about the antecedent. And as we kind of work through this ABC model, I'm going to mix in both some information from the parenting stress literature and parenting literature, but I'll also draw on some of the thoughts and ideas and strategies that I use with families in my clinical practice as well. So there's two kind of models of parenting stress and the antecedents of parenting stress in particular. So I've mentioned Abedin, who's a pretty well-known parenting stress researcher. He, I guess, believes that parenting stress stems from kind of three main areas. So the first one would be the parent domain. And he described the parent domain as any kind of distress that parents experience within the parenting role specifically. So for example, parents may feel stress because they don't have time to do other things outside of the parenting role because so that caregiver role takes up so much of their free time. So they might experience just distress from that parenting role. The second factor is the child domain, and this is how challenging a parent might perceive it is to care for their child. So things like disabilities, perhaps extra needs, more challenging. It really just boils down to the perceived difficulty level of that caregiving role for that child. And then the third domain would be the parent-child relationship. And so this refers specifically to the quality of the relationship between parents and child and how much conflict there is within that relationship. So presumably more conflict, lower quality relationship, so that might contribute to higher levels of parenting stress. So the second main theory of parenting stress is the daily hassles theory. And so this is actually a much less researched theory of the causes of parenting stress. And so, I don't know if I'm pronouncing this right, but Cernick and Greenberg in 1990 came up with this idea that parenting stress is actually a result of daily hassles. So this kind of boils down to both the frequency of daily hassles and then the intensity of the daily hassles. So frequency might be having a lot of stressors, and then the intensity, of course, would range from low intensity stressors to high intensity stressors. And just to provide, I guess, a bit more context, so Cernick and Greenberg identified these hassles as low level chronic stressors. So these are things like scheduling difficulties, cleaning up messes. So if you find you have to do that a lot throughout the day, and depending on the intensity level of those stressors, parents might experience more parenting stress. So the analogy that I kind of think of for this one is almost like, you know, death by 1,000 paper cuts. So it's like really not that stressful, but it really does depend on the frequency and intensity. So really the distinctions between these two models of the sources of parenting stress, the one on the left here, Abedin's parent-child relationship theory, this is really focused on the parenting role and domains within the parenting role. Whereas Cernick and Greenberg, they're kind of thinking more about what kind of tasks, what kind of hassles are happening for the parent and how do they respond? So what are your thoughts on these theories? Does one fit better than the other or resonate more in terms of parenting stress?
Someone mentioned it's nice to label them.
Definitely. Something that I've thought about that I guess I won't get into too much detail here, but one of my interests in kind of learning about these two theories is just how they kind of fit together. So that's for my own personal interest. That's something that I've thought about.
Katie said, I feel like the first addresses other stressors on the parent outside of the parenting role.
Yeah,
And Heather said, both are both of huge factors for me. Bonnie, I have twin teenagers right now. The daily hassles really ring true for me and contribute to most of my stress. Aww.
Yeah.
Oh, here's Cheryl. I've heard many parents talk about the stress of creating meals for their family each day, every day. That would fit well into the latter theory.
Mm-hmm.
And death by a thousand paper cuts is perfect for how I feel.
Both useful models. Totally. And, you know, I think that was kind of my sense. I'm not a parent myself, so I can't really envision to the fullest extent of what it's like, but both models to me seemed like they would have some truth to them. They kind of focus on different aspects of parenting, but both seemed like they might offer something in terms of how we understand parenting stress and what the causes are. Thank you for your thoughts. And it's interesting to hear kind of how you guys see these two models fitting as well. Okay, so this is sort of just some other potential antecedents to parenting stress based on what's talked about or what is being researched within the parenting stress literature. So there's a lot of research on parenting stress as a result of children with developmental disabilities. So thinking more about those, like more doctor's appointments, maybe greater needs, and that I think could fall into both the daily hassles model as well as the parent-child relationship model, depending on the temperament of the child, number of children. Somebody mentioned before, if it's your first child, fewer support systems, poverty, the pandemic, and so other stressors from what parents have shared who've completed my dissertation study. They mentioned the media as being another stressor. And so the comparisons that people might make between themselves and people that they see online, co-parenting, I know somebody mentioned that in our chat as well. So other parents are definitely finding that as well as potential stressors. Stepchildren, blended family, for sure. So like the structure of families, I think can also play a role. So one way to kind of conceptualize all of these antecedents is with Bronfenbrenner's model. So this is a bioecological systems theory, which basically, there's a note here that I should have gotten rid of. Basically what you want to think about is the individual, so a child or a family kind of being at the center of these circles. So kind of right where that baby is in the picture. And you kind of have circles extending outwards from this child who's in the middle. And these represent different systems at play. And there's interactions between the systems as well. So within a family, you might have potential antecedents for parenting stress coming from individual members, the relationships between the members. You go out into the mesosystem and you have things like school and peers, the family system as a whole, and you can kind of get broader and broader. So that can be one way to also think about how different stressors, where they might come up more, and then also how they interact with one another. Anything else in terms of antecedents that you guys can think of that maybe we didn't cover or that that isn't on here?
Somebody mentioned, I think, stepchildren and blended families add to stress.
Yeah, That's a really good one.
And a child that has experienced trauma creates stress in almost all areas. And single parents of a child or children with disabilities.
For sure. Yeah. So the structures, you guys are hitting on those a lot. Children with disabilities, definitely trauma. We know that that has a huge impact on all those sort of, if you think about the circle, starting with the individual going outwards. Yeah.
And children dealing with death in the family.
Yeah, definitely. So those experiences and how they might stick with an individual or shape how they interact with those other facets of the family life or school peers. Yeah. Thank you. Okay, so moving on to the B. So this is the behavior. And so thinking about behavior more as a state of stress rather than maybe an action is kind of how I've conceptualized the behavior of parenting stress. So if you think about if you were walking down the street and you met somebody and they were a very highly stressed parent, what would that look like? Like, how would you be able to tell that they were stressed? So that's kind of what you want to think of when you think of what the behavior looks like. So it can kind of be broken down. This is a CBT, a cognitive behavioral therapy lens. So we often break down behaviors into thoughts, feelings, and then the physiology, so the physical responses. So when we think about the stress response, I think it can be helpful to think about it in terms of the thoughts you might be experiencing, the feelings that arise, as well as those physical responses. So here's an example of what a parenting stress behavior or stress response might look like. So the thought might be, I don't have time for the things I need to do to care for myself. The feelings that might accompany that thought could be anger, frustration, feeling overwhelmed. And then the physical responses that kind of accompany those thoughts and those feelings could be a racing heart, shortness of breath, kind of those typical like stress response symptoms. Okay, maybe that was any thoughts or questions about what the behaviors might look like? I see somebody else added a note about a potential antecedent. So balancing child stress and electronics, that's a huge one. Yeah, so important. And especially I think right now, so when we're all at home. Yeah. Okay, I will move on then to the consequence or outcome. Oh, here we go. Parents would display emotion dysregulations. For sure, yeah. And so that might be struggling to manage those emotions. So you might see very extreme levels of anger or really strong physiological responses. And that can sometimes look like, I guess, there's a kind of a spectrum. So you could see that as being like really high levels, intense, like arousal levels, so anger, sweating, but you can also see it kind of go in the other direction after those dysregulations. Sometimes it can look like shutting down, withdrawing, shutting out others. Yeah, so that kind of refers to the withdrawing, the shutting down, less engagement, for sure. If we think about the intensity levels of parenting stress and that continuum. So really, really high stress, you might see some parents fall on the lower end of that sort of intensity level spectrum.
Someone also mentioned more likely to use controlling tactics to get their child to obey.
Yes. So potentially some relation to how parents respond to their child and the parenting parenting practices. Yeah, awesome. Thank you guys for your substance abuse. Yeah, happy and sad. These are great. Thank you. Okay, so moving to the consequences or outcomes of parenting stress. So stress can increase a lot of different risk factors. So you can have more negative emotions and thoughts. It can lead to parent-child conflict, co-parenting conflict, as well as child maltreatment. And so actually one of the things that's recently being talked about in the news is that since September, the incidence rate of child maltreatment has gone up because of, well, not since September, I think since March. But we're seeing a lot more children being admitted to hospitals because of maltreatment kind of related injuries. And so I know in the news, the Children's Hospital of Eastern Ontario just reported that between September and January, the number of infants with injuries that were consistent with maltreatment tripled. So rose from 8 to 20. So parenting stress, I think this kind of ties into sort of this COVID window that we're in, this period that we're in, and how there's likely much greater levels of parenting stress and how this can really be taxing and overwhelming. Family violence, child abuse, I can see in the chat here. So definitely we're seeing some more of that. Parenting stress can also lead to decreases, so in attention resources, as well as self-directed time, so time that you might have for yourself, for work, other kind of areas of your life that are outside of that caregiving role. An interesting study by Miller, Shim, and Holden in 1998. So they examined mothers' parenting responses as a function of different settings. So they looked at mothers in the home, in the park, and then at a research lab. And then they looked at the amount of demands that they placed on the mothers in each of these settings. So making children's lunches, attending to paperwork. And the authors found that mothers paid significantly less attention to their children when they were in situations where there were a lot of other demands placed on them. And they have, and mothers articulated that they experience the most demands when they're at home. And so, you know, you can kind of see how the attention and the time and space that the mothers might have. When there's a ton of demands placed on them, might lead to fewer attention to spend on the children. Now, on the flip side, mothers in the same study by Miller and colleagues, they found that when mothers were in a situation where there were much fewer demands placed on them, then they actually reported being much happier and had more time to focus on caregiving. So I thought that was a kind of an interesting interaction between parenting stress and attention resources. Now we know that actually parenting stress is not all bad. There are actually some positive things that can come from parenting stress. When the stress is not overwhelming and it's kind of at a modest level. So in those situations where it's not overwhelming and a parent might experience modest amount of stress, we know that can actually lead to more coping mechanisms, perhaps more strategies, maybe enhanced strategies. We also see that parents might reach out more to build those support networks. So I'm thinking of the expression like it takes a village to raise a child. And we also know that an adversity is a necessary factor for resilience. So, you know, again, sort of contextualizing this to not debilitating levels of parenting stress, but those moderate amounts of stress can also lead to resilience. So I think it's important to highlight to highlight those other aspects to it as well. So I'll tie in a little bit about my doctoral dissertation research here. So one of the things that I'm really interested in learning about is emotion socialization. And this refers to the beliefs, goals, values parents have about children's experience of emotions, how children express emotions, how they manage their emotions. So it's emotion socialization is really the ways that parents teach children about emotions and how to manage those emotions. And parents do this in three main ways. So the first way is how they respond to children's emotions. So do they respond in ways that are really accepting, acknowledging of emotions, or do they respond by kind of maybe overriding or dismissing children's emotions? The second way that they parents engage in emotion socialization is their expression of emotions, so parents' own expression of emotions. And this can refer to not only your facial expressions, but also your the way that you carry, you know, your body position, vocal expressions, what you say, how you say it. And so these can demonstrate both positive and negative expressions in the home. So positive expression might be like expressing gratitude, whereas a negative one might be, you know, showing signs of anger or frustration. Just kind of as a little aside note, we know that when parents express positive emotions, this can lead to children learning how to express positive emotions, having more positive emotions. And there's actually not, I would say, consistent literature on what happens when parents express negative emotions. So some kind of researchers have found that this leads to children learning negative emotions and modeling those same negative emotions. But then other researchers have found that actually it can, you know, if you model negative emotions, but then talk to your child about it, that's maybe not a bad thing. So we're not actually quite sure yet about the effect of negative emotions, but potentially when done or expressed in an appropriate way is maybe not a bad thing. And so the third way that parents can engage in emotion socialization is the types of discussions that they have with their children about emotions. So this can sort of teach children about emotions, so it can increase their vocabulary and their language to articulate their emotional experiences and how they're feeling. It can enhance children's understanding of emotions and awareness of emotions. And it also models for children that it's okay to talk about emotions. So these are kind of the ways that children learn about emotions and how to manage their emotions. And we know that this is really important, emotion socialization, because it has a really big impact on, of course, children's ability to manage their emotions, so their emotion regulation, but also their social competence. So when we think about how children engage with peers, you know, how good are they at initiating relationships, maintaining relationships, all these things. And we know that when parents tend to engage in more supportive emotion socialization, this leads to better social competence, better emotion regulation skills. And when parents tend to engage in maybe less supportive emotion socialization, then this is related to children's internalizing and externalizing disorders. So those are things like anxiety, depression, maybe oppositional defiance. So it can be, I guess, a strong outcome or indicator of how well children learn about social skills and emotion regulation. So what I'm interested in understanding more through my doctoral dissertation is what is the effect of parenting stress on their emotion socialization practices? Is there an effect? And we actually don't really know. People haven't looked at this specifically. So I think that's, for me, that's a very important question. And it kind of arose from, initially, my interest was in children's emotion regulation. And then I, of course, was like, well, you know, like, yes, that's very important, but how do they learn those skills? And then it's like, okay, emotion socialization is really important if this is sort of the primary way that children, I think up until about age 11 to 13, this is the primary way that children learn emotion regulation is via emotion socialization. But then that kind of naturally led me to what are the upstream factors that affect emotion socialization potentially. So that led me to wanting to learn more about parenting stress and the relationship between parenting stress and emotion socialization. So I have a video here for you guys about what emotion socialization can look like in practice, and just those interactions between parents and children in a way that can help scaffold or help children learn about how to manage emotions. So I'll just get this set up here and I'll turn my video off to help.
Why did you do this, Allie? This is terrible.
Oh, great.
This is Michael's giraffe. He's crying now. Why did you do this?
Cause.
Cause is not an answer.
Active listening.
Ray, that doesn't work.
It works. I just use on the worst kids in the neighborhood.
Would you look at this? Look what she
just
did.
Try it. Try it.
No, Ray.
I'll do it. You want me to do it?
No. Okay. Allie, let's talk about what you did.
I don't want to talk.
Are you feeling angry?
Reflect back.
You're angry.
Yes.
Okay. But it's not okay to rip up toys when we're angry.
I'm judgmental.
You are angry because...
Because it used to be your toy.
Oh.
Yes.
I see. You think that mommy and daddy pay too much attention to Michael and Jeffrey.
Right, okay, I was handling this.
They get everything.
Right, and you're upset because we gave them your old giraffe.
I still liked it.
But you weren't playing with it.
But that doesn't matter, though, because it was still yours. And you're mad because we gave it to Michael without asking you, right?
Right.
Well, mommy and daddy made a mistake, and everybody makes mistakes, right, mommy?
Yes.
You feel better now, Allie?
Yes. Can I have the giraffe?
Well, it's broken, honey.
I know. I want to try to fix it for Michael.
See what I did there?
Yeah. Can't believe it. It's pretty amazing. You did it.
Anything else need taken care of while I'm around here?
No.
What? What's the matter?
Nothing with you, obviously.
Don't go by me. I'm a natural.
So proud of yourself. Listen, if I hadn't dragged you to that stupid class, you'd still be standing there going, hey, no TV.
You're feeling inadequate because I mastered it before you.
Don't give me that active listening crap. Where do you get off listening to me?
Never happen again.
Okay, let me get reset up again here. So I think I really like that video. I think it injects some humor, but also provides a interesting perspective of emotion socialization and just those interactions between parents and children when trying to respond to children's emotions, reflect those emotions, build that emotional awareness. So I quite like that video. Okay. So now just kind of moving over into when we think about managing parenting stress, I really just wanted to highlight that, you know, we always want to be thinking about different strategies for managing stress. I think any kind of stress, parenting stress, stress that happens outside of the caregiving role. So I kind of think when thinking about these strategies, I wanted to show that on the bottom, you kind of have average stress levels. So I think it's important to practice these strategies, whether you're kind of at the average stress level, maybe more intentional activities as you kind of move up towards high stress or clinically elevated levels of stress. But definitely we want that the baseline to be doing some things for self-care and managing stress. So the first tool that I have here that I like to use in my work with families is talking about the window of tolerance. So this is a really, really interesting model, I think, of understanding stress and our own stress responses. It was created by the National Institute for the Clinical Application of Behavioral Medicine, and it's often introduced within the context of trauma, but I think is quite relevant for, as I said, kind of that baseline green average levels of stress plus. So just to kind of orient you to this diagram here. So in the middle here, you have your window of tolerance. So this is kind of where you tend to feel most balanced, most centered, you know, you're kind of grounded. You might feel stress, but the effect is you're pretty able to navigate it. It doesn't really derail your day or how you're feeling or anything like that. So this is really like the ideal place to be. And when we have our window of tolerance, you can think of it as kind of being malleable. So when we have a lot of stressors happening in our lives, then the window of tolerance shrinks. And when we are doing lots of things that sort of engage in those self-care practices that nurture our own feelings, both within the parenting role and outside, these things can grow our window of tolerance. And depending on, I guess, how stress affects you as an individual. If you have a smaller window of tolerance and more stresses, you might go into a hyperarousal level. And so this is when you might feel anxious or angry, overwhelmed, and the body just goes into fight or flight. So some people might respond with hyperarousal when they get very stressed. Other people might go into hypoarousal. And so this is when they might feel spacey or zoned out. Their body just wants to shut down when they're feeling really overwhelmed with stress. And so these things, you know, it's not really like we have the choice to go into hyper or hypoarousal. It just kind of happens in terms of how we naturally respond when we have a smaller window of tolerance. And so some of the families that I work with, they've described things that help grow their window of tolerance. So one parent mentioned having an afternoon nap, like just at some point before the dinner kind of window starts, having a nap just helped give them a little bit of an extra boost of energy and sort of navigate any sort of hiccups that might arise between after school and bedtime. Whereas another parent, they said, their sort of self-care activity that grew their window of tolerance was going outside for a walk. And that was something that they needed to do on a daily basis to just kind of give them that balance and ground them for future interactions. So I think that's something that can be very helpful to be mindful of, regardless of stress level, and just kind of thinks about, you know, where are you at and what kinds of things work for you. Another sort of proactive or strategy that can be useful for the average plus levels of stress or different relaxation strategies. So this kind of targets that physiological responses of stress that we might experience. So when we think about racing heart or maybe flooding thoughts, that fight or flight response, these are really good activities that can help reduce those physiological symptoms of stress. So deep breathing is a great one. Just sometimes like counting for 7 seconds in, 11 seconds out, or some people do 4 and 4, whatever works best for you, but finding ways to sort of take deep, calm breaths. Our body sort of stops that fight or flight, because in those fight or flight instances, we would not kind of be pausing to do these like very deep calming breaths. So usually it can really sort of help you pull you out of those moments. Another similar activity is box breathing, but in box breathing, you actually hold your breath after your inhale, and then as well as after your exhale. So people kind of think of it as like inhaling for 4 seconds, holding their breath, exhaling for 4 seconds, holding their breath again. So that's kind of how you get the box visualization. And you can feel free to Google some of these strategies, like the deep breathing or box breathing. There's lots of scripts online for or how-tos about how to do these. Some people like imagery, so visualizing a very calming, relaxing place that they can go to. This can be helpful for when, like at night, if you're trying to fall asleep and just kind of need to get out of your head, or if you're finding yourself feeling frustrated. And then some other people like muscle relaxation or progressive muscle relaxation. And so this is when you sometimes contract and then consciously relax different muscles in your body, usually in sort of a progressive way. So starting from the head down or feet up. And that can really just help relax muscles and build that sense of relaxation. Okay, and so this is a strategy, I call it hitting the pause button. This was something that can be very helpful for more in the moment stress. So if you think about, so the ground floor, if you think about a building and maybe an elevator within this building. So the ground floor is sort of this baseline level that we operate at. So on the ground floor, we're feeling logical, we're receptive to arguments of logic. You know, if you talk to somebody, you're kind of in a space where you can really hear what they're saying. And then if you think about the elevator going up, we can kind of get more and more heightened stages of arousal. And so as we kind of move up and go up to the elevator, go up the floors or go up the elevator, we get less open or less receptive to information, to reason. And so in those stages, when we're kind of maybe have a penthouse view of how things are at, it can be really hard to respond calmly and in ways that we might otherwise respond if we were at the ground level. A lot of really good communication happens at the ground floor, not at the penthouse. So I often tell families to kind of try and hit the pause button. If you stop and think about in the moment, am I ground floor or like fourth floor or penthouse right now? Sometimes it can be really helpful to pause and just take a little bit of a break if possible. We know that a lot of times talking about consequences or things like that or discipline is not always the most effective when we ourselves are at the penthouse. Sometimes we dole out consequences or punishments that maybe aren't the fitting for the situation or that we actually might have a hard time implementing. Like if you think about no screen time for a month or something like that, like that really doesn't work well for anyone and could be a punishment more for yourself than for your kids as well. So it can be really helpful to take some time, let your body return to baseline, 20 minutes is usually the amount of time that it takes for our the physiological symptoms to calm back down. It can be helpful to tell your child in advance if you need to hit the pause button. Maybe 20 minutes is too much time in the moment. But you know, whatever works for you and for your family, but try to hit the pause button and just return to things and talk it through. Think about a consequence at a later time if it's related to a misbehavior or rule breaking, things like that. So that can be really helpful for just kind of, yeah, helping yourself get back down to baseline. And then reframe. So this is an expression that I heard that really stuck with me from when I was in Edmonton doing a practicum placement at a hospital there. And one of the psychologists would often say, children are having a hard time, not giving a hard time. And it can be really helpful to think about, usually children want to please. They want to do well. They want your praise and validation. And sometimes when they're behaving in ways that aren't worthy of that praise and validation, sometimes there's an underlying challenge that might be contributing to that. So whether it's a skill deficit, whether they're afraid, they're worried about something. So that can be a factor that might be related to a behavior that you see on the surface, which might be not listening or rule breaking. So in those moments, trying to see potentially if there's an underlying cause and to remind yourself that there's probably something maybe deeper that's happening, that's contributing to them having a hard time meeting those expectations in that situation, can help give parents sometimes a bit more empathy or different perspective, and can help keep them calm in times of distress. And then the last one here, so seeking support, and whether that's friends and family, parenting groups online, there are a lot of online parenting groups, or more formal supports like a parenting program. Seeking supports is a really helpful way for managing stress, for parenting stress. And so the literature by Green and Lee, they identified, they conducted a few research studies with parents and their experience of attending parenting programs. And one of the things that parents who were attending these programs articulated was how much they enjoyed and benefited from the support of their peers, from other parents. So they felt less alone in any struggles they were encountering in the parenting role. They learned different tricks, strategies for staying calm, for managing children's behavior. And so this was something that was a really, really big help. And we know within the parenting stress literature as well, this can be one of those moderating resources. So if you remember the stress process model, you have the stressful event and then the resources, and then you have your outcome. Well, more support system can really help offset the impact of the stressful event. Okay, and so kind of going back to my dissertation research here, one of the things that hasn't been explored very well within the emotion socialization and parenting stress areas is the role of self-efficacy. So self-efficacy or parenting self-efficacy is the expectation that parents have about their ability to parent successfully. And we know that greater levels of self-efficacy is actually related to more supportive caretaking, more monitoring, involvement, and can lead to improvements in children with externalizing behaviors. So those more acting out behaviors. So one of the things that I'm wondering is how might confidence levels or those self-efficacy beliefs play a role in the impact of parenting stress on emotion socialization. So I'm curious if parents who have like greater levels of self-efficacy might perceive parenting stress differently than those who have lower levels of self-efficacy, and if that might change in turn how parents engage in those emotion socialization practices. And the reason why I think this is kind of an interesting angle to get at is when we think about those parenting programs, things that can really help parents with their parenting role, if we know that self-efficacy might really impact how parents perceive stress and then in return engage in emotion socialization, then this could be something that we could be looking at as almost like a lever for helping parents manage stress. Okay. Maybe I'll pause here and just see, are there any questions so far or any comments?
Well, somebody just wrote that you're really helping them this morning and your voice is very assuring.
Thank you. That's very nice. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Katie says, looking good so far.
Okay.
All good. Okay.
Sounds good. So I'll move into my research study. So this is an ongoing study right now. So it's currently running. It's called the Parenting Experience Survey. So it's an online questionnaire that parents can complete, parents specifically with a child between 7 to 11 years of age. And the questionnaire takes about 30 minutes. So the reason why I'm thinking the sort of 7 to 11 year age window, we know that in middle childhood, this is sort of the middle childhood years, children learn a lot of new emotion regulation skills. And so this is a really important time for those emotion socialization practices. And also when we think about how parents might engage in those emotion socialization practices, it looks very different for like a 2-year-old versus a 5-year-old versus a 13-year-old. So just in terms of that like sort of more research focused lens, it's helpful for us to define a certain window in child development so that we're kind of looking at similar types of emotion socialization practices. So my questions for my dissertation research is how stressed are parents in their parenting role? I've had the, I don't know if it's a fortune or misfortune, this study has been up and running since April 1st of last year. So it's coincided quite perfectly with COVID, which is totally fine. But I imagine that that the outcomes I'm getting right now might be not super generalizable to or representative of how parents might feel in non-COVID times. But it's still worth asking, and I think it's very important to know how stressed are parents in their parenting role. And I'm looking at, you know, both that caregiving role piece as well as the daily hassles piece. Oh, right, yes. So that's my number two. So how do the parent-child relationship and daily hassles theories relate to parenting stress and to one another? So these two theories haven't been looked at super well simultaneously. So I'm just wondering if, you know, maybe we count both pieces of antecedents of parenting stress, if that might give us a more holistic understanding. And then how do parenting stress and self-efficacy relate to those emotion socialization practices? And is self-efficacy something that we should be looking at within more like, I guess, clinical samples of either with parents or those more intensive parenting programs? Because if that can lead to lower levels of stress or can help parents in any way, then I think that's something that we should be thinking more about. So what is the role of self-efficacy in parenting stress and parent emotion socialization? Okay, so the parenting experience study so far, I've had 220 parents respond, 93% mothers, 56% have boys between 7 to 11 years of age. And these are all parents from the community. So anyone is welcome to contribute. Let's see.
I've popped that survey into the chat box. I know it comes up later in the presentation handout that I'll be sending out, but I've just popped it into the chat box for now.
Perfect. Thank you. So I think this is, I mean, obviously I'm very biased because it's a Hyung study, but I believe in this study because I think the findings are going to be very helpful on different fronts. So first and foremost for families, you know, I think it's really important for families to be able to understand the stress that they're experiencing within the parenting role. I think clinically, we always teach that monitoring and awareness is the most important thing. So for us to know what that looks like, and so we can talk to parents about what that looks like and help them understand and manage stress. I think it will lead to more positive parent-child reactions and can help parents teach children about emotions. So I think it's really important for us to understand all like the emotion socialization piece and stress piece for all these reasons with families. Also within the sort of scientific knowledge base, we know it's really important to fill in gaps in knowledge. And so I think this is a pretty glaring gap. And I want to better understand what some of the causes and outcomes of parenting stress are, and how to support parents who are in that sort of elevated or clinically elevated range. And then for that clinical practice, we can provide more resources to parents that fit what their parenting stress experiences are. And we can use this study to inform parenting support programs so that they're based on evidence. So if you would like to get involved, please feel free. Here's the link. The link that Wendy posted in the chat it's the same link. So if you have a child between 7 to 11 years of age, please feel free to complete the survey. There's lots of perks for the survey. So you'll get a summary of your responses about parenting stress, as well as the parenting practices and self-efficacy. So you'll get some insight into that. And I think there's also a draw for a $50 chapters gift card. The odds are 1 in 10, I believe. 1 in 100.
1 in 10 would be great.
You know, I was like, wait a minute. I don't think we have the funding. That might be a little... it's a student-led study, so I think it's 1 in 100. but you can also enter a draw. You get the results of the summary of your participation regardless, but there will also be a draw when the study ends. And if you have any questions, please feel free to email me. My email is up there. And then maybe... So just wanted to say thank you guys so much for joining me on a Saturday morning. And I'd like to open it up to any questions that you might have.